expecting that.
A tough weekend for the league-leading Milwaukee Bucks. First, they lose to the Lakers Friday night. Then they lose Giannis. Giannis out at least two games after straining his knee in that game. Nick, is this something or nothing? You worried about it?
Oh, I'm not worried. I think that the Bucks and Giannis and the whole league, by the way, last thing we need with Steph finally coming back and Zion being back is Giannis going down. So I'm glad Giannis is okay. He's going to miss tonight's game, maybe a couple more after this. Where it is something is the Bucks now are done with trying to win 70 games. They already got 11 losses. They ain't going to get to 70. And this does keep the door even a little more ajar for LeBron to close the gap, if not overtake Giannis in MVP voting.
Giannis will be fine. Miles Sprain, I played the whole Big Three season last year with a torn patella. He'll be fine.
I had my knee kind of hanging off
now,
me this
now
way.
Now you're retired, you said.
Yeah,
you did.
So that's a bad example.
Now I made the championship.
But now you're coaching now.
Yeah.
Yeah, but we want to see you play, Stack. You were talking about coming to the league 2 years ago, remember?
Yeah, no, my love of the game is leaving a little bit.
Oh, stop! Are you serious?
Playing-wise, yes.
Oh, our number one story, the Lakers.
This is our number one story. Stack doesn't love the game.
Fresh off that win over the Bucks on Friday, LeBron and AD back at it again yesterday against Kawhi and the Clippers. Business as usual for the 35-year-old, 17-year veteran in LeBron James. Finished with 28-7-9, while the Brow added 30-8. It's a lot of numbers. Lakers get the win. Nick, I ask you, who has the edge if these teams match up in the playoffs?
Jenna? This is the easiest question you have asked me all day.
All lifetime.
It might be the easiest question you ask me all year.
You're welcome.
And so let me look right into this camera right here, if I could, and speak directly to my friend Skip Bayless, my dear friend and mentor Colin Cowherd, my friend Marcellus Wiley, all the lineup post us on this network who have been Clip City, Chip City all year long. What you got left?
Oh, boy.
What's the argument? I'm just curious, because you were holding on for dear life, like a mountain climber onto the last little rock. 2-0. They played twice. They won twice. So the first one was first game of the year, and nobody knew each other. Second one was Christmas Day, and it was a 3-point game with 8 seconds left. But it was 2-0. Now what you got? Lakers got the better record. They got the better player. They got the better offense. They got the better defense. They will play every single game in the series with a massive home court advantage, and they're healthier. So what do you got? Hope, prayer, luck, good fortune? I don't know. Because logic says no shot. None. So I understand it's anticlimactic. Build up. Battle of Los Angeles. This is what we're going to get to see. Okay. What we saw yesterday, Stephen, was you build a team to stop LeBron without the single most important piece to stopping LeBron, someone to meet him at the rim. You built a team to stop no one. Because LeBron will hunt the mismatch and make Lou Williams feel like, man, he should have been in the big three with you. And all of a sudden, if you send a double, guess what? Good God, that's Avery Bradley's music. There's Kyle Kuzma open in the corner. Danny Green, even though he didn't make a shot, there's he wide open.
But Nick, it was a close game.
Good God, that's Avery Bradley.
It was a close game yesterday.
Yeah, listen.
Was it just a few tweaks from the Clippers to keep it even closer and then maybe prevail?
Yeah, I felt like the Lakers were in firm control of the entire second half. And at no point after midway through the third quarter did I think there was any chance Lakers were going to lose. Sometimes games appear closer than they are, and the Lakers controlled that game because the Clippers built a team to stop LeBron that also has Anthony Davis. And by the way, Paul George ain't going to play better than he played yesterday. What'd that get you? Marcus Morris thinks he's the best player on the team. Spoiler alert, man, you're the seventh best player on the team. So you got some issues there. At least you can rely on Kawhi to get that mid-range jump shot. It'd be nice if you could rely on Kawhi to get anyone else involved ever, but not his game.
How many assists did Kawhi have?
Same as me. And so I just don't know, Steven, how they beat him 4 out of 7 times, especially when all 7 games are going to be in L.A.
Well, after this game, you've seen that LeBron, he took the game a little bit more serious this time, but when they play again, none of these 4 games will matter when it comes down to the playoffs. It's going to come down to coaching, it's going to come down to preparation, and it's going to come down to what team takes away what the other team does well. None of this regular season stuff is going to matter at all when it comes down to playoff time.
Go ahead. No, we're going to ask the same question. Go.
I was going to say, break that down. Coaching, advantage?
I don't know yet. If I have to have
my point is there's a lot of questions to all the things.
Yeah, and I think if I have to go coaching advantage, I would go Clippers. I think Doc will have his team more prepared, but I think as far as personnel, I think Lakers have the better personnel. But I think both coaches could have their teams prepared, but it all depends on who follows the game plan and who does the best job of taking teams out what they like to do best.
It is worth kind of noting, and I agree. Listen, Doc's a champion. Doc's got a great resume. Frank Vogel has coached in the conference finals more recently than Doc. Now, in Doc's defense, all he had was Chris Paul and Blake Griffin and DeAndre Jordan at their peak, so you can't expect him to make third round of the playoffs. But
you can't compare a coach that won a championship to a coach that – let's not do that, Nick.
Ooh, okay, well, then let's compare them in 3 months.
But no, we're talking now. You can't compare a coach that's won a championship.
Listen, Doc's great. I just
can't
feel like,
do that.
I feel like it's a long time since Kevin Garnett was there. That. That's all. Listen, but what do I know? Go ahead, Wilds. I apologize.
Well, I like the palace intrigue of, like, who's going to wear the crown. And we've heard that LeBron isn't actually worried about this crown thing. But I think the New Balance commercial bothered him.
He wanted that chip. He won that championship. Winning the championship in a Lakers uniform after everything that's been going on with Kobe.
I'll buy that.
Do you think this
bothers him when this has New Balance commercial, it's got a little crown here?
Nah, because he could do a commercial every week if he wanted to, and with a crown. Like, this little stuff doesn't matter to LeBron James.
When he's looking for any little tiny edge?
Nah.
I think it would.
So then
Kuzma puts, and then Giannis, like, guess what? I've got the crown.
Yeah, because Giannis still has a lot to prove. He hasn't really done anything.
That's what
I'm
saying. I think this bothers LeBron. Kuzma puts the crown on. Look, Caruso loves it. Oh, you've got the crown, buddy.
Even if you take the crown out of it, you don't think LeBron went into that game knowing all the talk about how maybe Kawhi was like, oh, there you go.
Oh, more
there
crown.
You go. Of course he hears it and
loves
he knows it.
He loves it.
It's got to be.
Look at the
lion. Him up a little bit.
I think if he heard anything, he heard that he didn't play or take the challenge the last two games against the Clippers.
I'll buy that.
And maybe he came out with more of the sense of urgency to win the game. I've seen that. But as far as the chatter, LeBron has heard so much over his career. He's heard worse.
When did he hear the most chatter, Stack? When was it at its absolute apex?
The year they won, they came back and won three.
The negative chatter.
The negative chatter. He heard a lot of negative chatter that year.
I would argue that when it was at its apex was 2011, the Mavs series. The Mavs series when he doesn't win in the fourth quarter.
We had D. Wade. You can't just put all that on him.
Yeah, but I'll even say it. Listen, game five of that series is the low moment of his career. And then they lose game six, and at that point he has no titles, and there are question marks. LeBron hears these things, but he also knows what I know. Since that moment, the most reliable thing in all of sports, that at the end of the year, LeBron James is going to remind you he is in a class by himself. The year after that 2011 series, NBA champion, finals MVP, including on the way there, the single greatest game of his career, 45-15-5 in Boston. The year after that, NBA champion, finals MVP, including 37-12 in game 7 of the NBA finals. The year after that, he gives you 28 points per game on 58% shooting and 52% from three, and the guy guarding him, who held him to that, gets finals MVP in Kawhi Leonard, because you're like, wow. You held LeBron to 28 on 58%. The year after that, he ends the season going 36-13-9. And the guy guarding him gets finals MVP. Because, wow, you held LeBron to 36-13-9.
You won MVP because you win the championship.
Well, they could have given it to anyone on those teams. And they held it to the guys who held LeBron to a cumulative average of 34-12-8. But that's fine. The year after that, what you're talking about, the greatest comeback in NBA history, 3-1.
Yeah.
The year after that, he averaged a triple-double in the finals. And the year after that, he took the four of us to the finals and went 51-8-8 in game one. And then he misses one year.
Us, but that was the best performance to me, that game one.
Stacks, okay.
Stacks four for NBA.
And that's the last time.
Yeah, I ain't done nothing like that. I'm not offended. Trust me. I didn't put up no numbers like that.
That's the last time we saw him in the playoffs. Because last year he got hurt. And all of a sudden, you got folks, friends of mine, going on ESPN doing their top five players in the league. He ain't on it. Your good buddy, Bill Simmons, put Nikola Jokic ahead of him going into the season. It's true. Jokic 7, LeBron 8.
They're looking for a hot take, Nick.
No. People say, you know why? Because people said it's year 17. He's played the third most minutes ever. He's only played 60,000 minutes. He can't keep doing that. But he can, because he's better than your best. your best all time, your best right now. So, he's better than your favorite, and he still is.
He's better. He's at all time.
Yeah. Ooh, yeah. It's becoming overwhelming. Yeah,
it's only a 3-hour show.
Come on now. It's becoming overwhelming. In Jordan's defense, in year 17, he hadn't played in 2 years.
Okay. Well, just let me know when Jordan loses in the finals.
Okay. So here we go. We tried
time this. Now to set your DVR. Nugget, just so I'm clear, so you have Lakers over the Clippers, I think. I don't even remember what the question was. Okay. I don't even think we had that conversation. Nuggets hosting the Bucks tonight. Milwaukee will be without Giannis as he nurses that sprained knee. Nick, what does this game mean?
Oh, I think this game's really interesting for a couple reasons. One is the Nuggets, if they're trying to move up to that two line, they need it. And the Bucks, if they lose, not only is 70 wins gone, because it would be the 12th loss, the only way you get to 70 is you go undefeated, but all of a sudden the Lakers, only one game back of the Bucks for best record in the NBA. A big part of Giannis's narrative wasn't just they're going to have the best record. Mm-hmm. They might win 70. If they end up having the same record as the Lakers in the easier conference, that'll swing some MVP votes LeBron's way. I don't have a vote, so I don't have to worry about that. But I think it's a really
first
big game.
First time hearing of this.
I think it's a really big game for a Bucks team that just
you don't have an NBA. You don't have a
I don't have any votes.
Why not, Nick?
I don't know.
It can spiral. If they lose, it can come. It become contagious.
It'd be 4 out of 5.
You think?
Milwaukee, yeah. Especially not having the Greek Freak, and I don't really see any other dominant player on their team. They have a all-star Middleton, but how dominant is he?
If they lose tonight, they will have lost 4 games in their last 5 after losing 8 games in their first 60.
Wow.
That ain't great.
Must-win game.
You don't want to do that in March.
Take a break. Coming up, guys, why is Draymond Green coming for Charles Barkley's job? That's ahead.
Someone tell Draymond to turn the film on.